For the town board meeting Thursday, April 21st, 2016, please rise and salute the flag.
Allegiance to the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Emergency exits are to my right during the town attorney and also the door you came in. Roll, please.
Councilman DeWango?
Here.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Here.
Councilwoman Hinselberger?
Here.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
And Supervisor Perotti?
Here. Public comment? Supervisors report. I had a meeting with Supervisor George Kay and Councilman John Merwin on April 20th at the Town of Northeast Town Hall regarding the RFP for ambulance services. Apparently, Northern Dutchess Paramedics came to their quarterly ambulance service meeting to discuss and negotiate a contract for 2017 and beyond. Since they are satisfied with what was offered, they will not be participating with the Town of Amenia's RFP. I have arranged with the Dutchess County Department of Emergency Response to have a citizens preparedness training here at the Amenia Town Hall on Tuesday, May 24th. You will be able to acquire the tools and resources to better prepare for any type of disaster, learn how to respond accordingly in a disaster, and recover as quickly as possible to pre-disaster conditions. Each family will receive a free citizen preparedness corps response starter kit. The event is free and it's open to the public. This Saturday, on April 23rd, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., the Town of Amenia with Senator Sue Serino and the Council on Addiction Prevention and Education of Dutchess County are presenting Ending Overdose in the Harlem Valley Resources, in the Harlem Valley, Resources, Action, Hope. Join us for a comprehensive event. Understand addiction, identify the signs, know where to get help. Narcon training, learn to administer this life-saving antidote and get a free kit. Shed the meds, dispose of your unused prescription medications. And thank you for our community partners. This is being done with CAPE of Dutchess County, Harlem Valley Community Coalition, Congressman Chris Gibson, Dutchess County Executive Marcus Molinaro, Dutchess County Department of Behavioral and Community Health, Weepatuck School District, Town of Amenia, Sharon Hospital, and Rebelard Public Relations. On April 18th, I had a conference call with Kimberly Ray, our environmental attorney, and Scott Diet from DEC, as we're moving toward closure of the Old Amenia landfill. For the site, before it can close, we have to get a final approval for our site management plan and our final engineering report from the New York State Department of Health, which we haven't received yet. In order to complete the final engineering report, an easement needs to be filed, and that will be filed next week by our environmental attorney. We're just waiting for final comments from the DEC and the Department of Health, so we can actually have final closure. The environmental attorney, Kimberly Ray, is finishing up the RFPs to send to the companies who will be doing the post-closure monitoring. Town clerk report.
Good evening. On April 11th, I attended the heating system and asbestos bid opening. That is an agenda item, so everybody's already received my minutes from that meeting. The town clerk's office has reviewed the vouchers dated on the abstract of April 19th, 2006, which is consisting of 8 pages that were audited. And the amounts are as follows. General Fund A, $67,093.33. Highway Fund DA0, $19,802.77. Amenia Lighting, SL1, $3,221.16. Wasafe Lighting, SL2, $1,051.92. Amenia Water, in the amount of $6,340.68. For our total of our monthly bills, $97,509.86. You guys ready to move on those? Or would you like to come back to vouchers?
I'll make a motion that we approve the payment of the vouchers in the total amount of $97,509.86.
Second.
Councilman Delango?
Abstain.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Councilman Hitzelberger?
Abstain.
Councilman Doyle?
Yes.
And Supervisor Prodi?
Yes.
Thank you. The Emergency Response Committee met this past week. We did find some additional minor changes in meeting with the Wasake Fire Chief. We are making those changes and circulating that to the rest of the committee. And once all of the committee members have had the opportunity, I will go ahead and send it to the board for their final approval. Also via email, I've circulated to the town board the 2016 Intermunicipal Electronic Content and Management Systems, ECMS Policies and Procedures Manual that was submitted to me by the town of Dover Town Clerk, who is taking the lead on this project. So if you guys would be so kind to review that, and we'll have that part of our first meeting in May's agenda. I did have the opportunity to attend the Narcan training and the substance abuse class that was held at the Dover High School, which is going to be held here this Saturday. I'd like to encourage all of our town residents, if you have not already registered or kind of on the cusp about coming or not coming, it's a great opportunity to see the services that we have here in our community. There are services that are located at your high school, in your surrounding towns. Addiction, you know, there is help, there is hope. And I want everybody to know that we can talk about this. And, you know, please, if you can clear your schedule on Saturday, come here to the Amenia Town Hall, meet with our volunteers, meet with our local officials, and discuss the issues that's happening right here in our backyard.
You want to give them a number to RSVP? Okay.
If you've not already RSVP'd or seen this on our website or on our television, you can call to RSVP by calling 845-518-4636. Saturday is a very busy day. I know Christine Ford's already announced it. Saturday is opening day baseball in the town of Amenia. So as your former Miss Baseball, come support your Tiny Tots out there and enjoy a good game on a Saturday. But when you're not visiting the firehouse or coming here, if you're not at the ball fields, you can be at our local firehouses. This weekend is Recruit New York. All of our firehouses are opening our doors. If you have questions, you want to just see those vehicles that we have, stop by. Monday, Amenia is having theirs on April 23rd from 10 to 1, and then Wasake is opening their doors. They're having their event up here on 22 on Sunday. So support your local volunteers. That's it this evening.
Highway Department report. Sweeping roads and grading dirt roads have been completed. We are now doing potholes. We plan to start Butts Hollow Road starting next week. Weather permitting, replacing catch basins and culvert pipes, then move on to blacktop fuel pump system. If you're spending $4,527.54 for engineering, $39,141.13 for new tanks and pumps, and the fuel master system, totaling $43,668.67, the new system is by far less accurate and a lot more paperwork. The situation is completely the opposite of what we were looking for. On April 19, 2016, we had United Pump and Tank Incorporated come to the highway garage After doing a quick inspection, he confirmed that the new system is not accurate, and he would have to come back and look at the system closer to determine what is wrong. He will provide a quote, and then we can go from there. On April 12, 2016, when we updated our fuel usage chart, our diesel tank read 55.1 gallons, too much in our tank. This has been going on since the tanks were installed. If you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to call me, Stan. Are there any other committee reports? Historian. Okay, heating system bids and electrical work bids. You have the what the bids came in as, which were higher than expected. And then one of the bidders, the low bidder, withdrew his bid because of a mathematical error. And we received no bids for the electrical. Would you want to address that?
Good evening, everybody. Pete Sotero. We received open bids on April 11th for the asbestos removal. And there was also two bids that were put out, one for the HVAC system and one for the electrical. The electrical had to be put out separately because any project that's over $500,000 has to conform to the Wicks law. So you have to have separate contracts for the trades. So for this particular project, the only trades we had were HVAC and electrical. So they had to be put out as separate projects. The project was advertised. I was able to talk to the county, and through their purchasing department, not only was it advertised in, I believe it was advertised in the Millerton News, but it was also put on Empire BidNet by the county, which, you know, circulates, you know, the notice of the bids to a very wide range throughout, you know, the state. So we received, as far as the asbestos goes, we received, let's go to the letter here. We received four bids ranging from approximately $17,000 to $57,000. We had provided a budget estimate of approximately $25,000. So the low bid was ATEC Group out of Fairfield, New Jersey. We have spoken to them. They sent us a list of the references. They do very extensive projects. We checked other references. You know, everybody seemed to have very good things, you know, to say about them. I spoke to the owner of the company. You know, the low bid was for $17,140. As part of the asbestos work, you have to have a third party come in and do the air monitoring. So we would have to retain someone like separate, you know, for that. It'd be like a testing firm. There's several within this area that like do this particular type of work. So assuming the town board is going to vote to move ahead with that, you know, we'll contact some of these other firms and get prices for, you know, the air monitoring. It should still fall within, you know, the $25,000 that we budgeted, you know, total for the project.
When will we get the prices for the air monitoring?
Well, assuming that, you know, you vote, you like to move ahead, I'll contact probably three firms either tomorrow, like, or Monday.
Okay.
And get some prices from them. As far as the heating system bids go, they were over budget. The town had bonded approximately $986,000 for the heating system part. The bids ranged from approximately $1,100,000, which was the low bidder, who has since rescinded his bid because they claimed they had a mathematical error. And the other bids ranged from approximately $1.2 million to $1.4 million. You know, we went through them. You know, it's kind of hard to say. you know, we talked to some contractors who we thought were going, you know, to bid it. There were three or four local companies that we had contacted and, you know, advised of the bids. Two of those companies came in, like, and picked up. One decided not to bid because they were, you know, too busy for their summer work. The other one said, you know, they shied away a little bit because of, you know, the pellet, you know, boiler. Not everybody knows that much about them. So I think there was a lot of unknowns with the project. You know, we took our estimates. Bob had taken his estimates from, you know, the many projects that we have done in the past. You know, we applied those. It's just, you know, every project, you know, is different. It's hard to figure, you know, what contractors think about the job, how they're going to, like, price it. You know, it's hard to say how much influence, you know, the pellet boiler may have had in, you know, the bids. You know, it's hard to say. So I wrote a letter. We came out last Thursday, Bob and I. We met with the supervisor. You know, we talked about some things. I wrote a letter Tuesday that I assume that, you know, you have. And, you know, the question is, how do we move forward from here? If you've got $986,000, you know, bonded, the only way that, you know, we can see, we've talked to several contractors, and I can let Bob talk a little bit further on that. But we feel that if we substitute an oil-fired boiler for the pellet boiler and put it out for bid again, that we should save at least $300,000 and possibly more on that. The other thing that we could do is instead of doing radiant panel heating along the bottom, we could go with a fin tube, which I can let Bob explain that more. We think that might save, you know, a little bit more money talking to some of the contractors that we did. So, you know, we feel like in order to get, you know, the number down to where you've got the money bonded, that, you know, the only way to cut out a major portion of the work is to substitute an oil-fired boiler for, you know, the pellet boiler. So, I don't know, Bob, do you want to add anything based upon what we talked to some of these guys about?
Yeah, I can just talk real quickly about the components. We did have a breakdown on the bids on certain items, and I don't have everything in front of me, but the cost for the breakdown for the pellet fires were coming in around anywhere from $250,000 to $300,000. The reason why the low bidder pulled out is because he didn't include labor for the installation of the pellet boiler. And his number was around $260,000, I believe. In addition to that, as you may see, I mean, we're a little concerned about giving you numbers anymore, but I'm trying to help walk through this a little bit. The control system for this installation was going to be in the neighborhood of $80,000 to $90,000. A lot of it, most of it, is because of, in order to get your rebate from NYSERDA, we had to record and document and prepare a report at the end of the year. And the controls that we had in place to do that were a little pricey. So if we proceed with another route, we can reduce the control numbers as well. If you guys have any questions for me, I'm here. I think my biggest error was probably in labor. Probably the installation is my labor installation. So installation labor. So.
And the whole project, or just the pellets?
The pellets.
Just the pellet stove or pellet fire?
I think mostly the pellets. I don't want to blame. I don't want to. You know. I don't. I think mostly the pellet part of it. Yeah. I won't know. You know what, 20, we won't know until we bid it again, exactly,
right.
So.
Well, I think more information is better than less, right?
Yeah.
We try a different route.
Well, my whole thing is, we had a meeting last year from Biomesa. This whole pellet system was $150,000 with the silo, the boiler, the controls, and everything. So how are we $300,000? You're $150,000 higher.
I don't have...
No, we didn't. We had, I mean, they were giving us a cost of $200,000.
Yeah, I know. I think I used their information.
Yeah, we've done, you know, hundreds...
So, I mean, is the problem in the system or is the problem in the bid spec? I mean, is the bid spec written away where it's over and above because you're not familiar with working with the pellet boiler?
I think I can answer that. The equipment, the basis of design equipment for the system was we used Mesa's equipment for basis of design. So we used...
Because I was at one of the NYSERDA meetings and it was like this was all new stuff. About how these controls were, they wanted the control to work this way and the control to work that way. So now, is the price off just because the bid spec was off?
I'm not sure what you mean by the bid spec being off. Our bid spec.
When you guys spec the boiler, you're going to say we want boiler type X. We need it to do this, and this.
Yes. Right. Yes.
So now that's how the bidder goes and he looks at the bid specs and he says, okay, we can make it do this, we can make it do that, and this is what it's going to cost.
The boiler that we spec was basically the boiler that, I'm not a heating guy. I don't want to blame on something that's not there.
I mean, we took the information from them. I mean, Bob's designed hundreds of heating systems. And, you know, we've never designed, you know, the pellet system. So we had to rely on, again, we're not throwing anybody under the bus. We're here trying to go figure this out. And, you know, but we had to take a lot of information from them, also from NYSERDA on some limited experience that they had with these. I believe they've been involved in like a couple of them.
I mean, we were talking about, you said you were off on the labor.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, me screwing a screw into the wall is screwing a screw into the wall. If it's a pellet boiler or if it's an oil boiler, you're still hooking a pipe up to it. You're still hooking electricity up to it. What's the difference in the labor in the pellet boiler?
The auger, for one thing.
Well, also Mike, for you know the pellet boiler, there was a separate flue that had to go up, the chimney. Because of, and I can let Bob explain, it had to be an insulated.
And we spoke about that a year ago, and we thought that the chimney was fine, that we didn't have to have a separate flow.
I wouldn't have said that. Here's why I know I wouldn't have said that, because you have two separate purifier systems, and they can't share a chimney. So I'm more than certain.
You can't share a chimney with.
Or if I said it, I wouldn't have meant to mislead anybody.
Okay.
You've got two separate fuel fire systems. They cannot share a chimney. I'm fully aware of that. And if I knew I was going down that route, I wouldn't have misled anybody. So, the piping for the boilers, because they do have two. We had two thermal storage tanks.
Yeah.
That's additional. See, the material, when I'm doing an estimate, and I can list the material, and I get the price of the material, because it's usually fairly black and white.
Yeah.
What happens is with the labor, you do the best you can with what you got, and you say, okay, how many man hours is it going to take to put this pipe from here to here? I'm going through a wall, I'm going to build a wall, I'm going to put a new door in. I got to take out a wall to bring the tanks in. And that's so each little item, especially in a renovation, that's why I think we won't know till the bid, if we go a different route when bids come in, we'll see where my biggest error is if we go that route.
But that isn't the problem, is the cost of the pellet boiler, the installation.
Well, the problem is they gave us the wrong amount for us to draw a bond on. Now we drew the bond already, and you know how much did the engineering cost for this? So far, what are we in engineering already?
For the whole project, or just for young pellet boiler?
For the whole project.
I want to say about 60. maybe 65 somewhere.
Yeah, we're into it for $65,000, and we got the wrong number for us to go get a bond.
Well, the, well, I mean, of the people who did the bidding, I mean, they know how much the pellet boiler is going to be compared to putting in another oil boiler.
I would like to say something about engineering costs. And this is in our defense. Generally, engineering costs are about 7.5% of a total project. That's a fair assessment on engineering costs. So $65,000 sounds like a lot of money, and it is a lot of money. So is $1.2 million. But the problem isn't what you paid us. We put together a good system that will work. The problem is the bond is less than the construction cost, and we got to figure out how to get down
to what.
But we picked the bond by what you guys told us.
You're right, Mike. Yep.
You know, so absolutely. Now we're kind of left holding the bag.
Yep.
I mean, we used your lead as the engineer to guide us and tell us what to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we might have to settle for a different system or something less, whatever, efficient or anything, because of the amount of money that we bonded.
Correct.
It's still going to be, the hydronic system is still going to be more efficient than the steam system we
have now.
Yeah,
but we're still, now you're going from a fin boiler to another thing. I mean, we're re-engineering the whole project again.
No, it's a very simple, change.
Because we already have the other two boilers going in, the oil ones, the two backup ones.
I mean, some of what we had to rely on, and again, not trying to push anything off, because some of it, it was us, but we had to rely on like others for certain parts of the job that we've never done. So, we took some costs from, other folks and plugged them in, and,
So it was on the job learning as far as the pellet boiler goes.
Yeah, some of it, yeah. The labor.
That cost us.
I wouldn't say.
We already knew the pellet boiler was going to cost more anyway.
We
understand that the pellet boiler was going to cost more. We had anywhere from $150,000 to $200,000, and you were getting a 40% NYSERDA grant.
No, you're
now
only,
we're saying that the pellet boiler is going to cost $300,000 to $400,000.
Yeah, I think.
Well, you're only going to get 80% of the grant for the construction anyway.
Okay, and then you get 20% after it runs for a year.
Yeah, if it meets their efficiency.
Okay, and if it's engineered right, it will meet the efficiency.
But the point is, we have to spend the money first. The grant money doesn't come in till after.
I understand all that.
But
it's just the way that I'm looking at it now is, and I don't sound like a jerk to you guys, but we hired you. We hired you for guidance, and we paid you for your guidance. We paid you for your expertise. Now we have an issue, and you're sitting here. And again, I don't want to be a jerk, but you're telling me you never designed one of these systems before, so there was unknowns.
Bob's mechanical engineer. There were some unknowns, but I don't mean to say that like a boiler is a boiler. But there was things that...
Let me back up a second. Unknowns are not... There's not technical unknowns. Technically, what you have in these drawings is a good, workable system that was technically designed by a technical person competently. That is not the problem. So I don't want to go down that route. The problem is we gave you a low estimate in which you took out a bond that is now not going to cover a competent design. So,
I want to make clear that some of the estimate we had to take from like others because we had, we and like the state.
And you took numbers.
We and the state don't have a big track record of hundreds of these things going in. So we had to take what other people were giving us for the cost of that to plug into the estimate, okay? And I'm not saying some of our numbers weren't low, but Bob's designed hundreds of systems. We bid them. We took like numbers from other projects that we've done, so there was some, every project is different. So, you know, when it's said that we gave a low estimate, yes, we did give, you know, the estimate. But what I'm trying to say is a very significant part of that estimate we had to take from others because we have no track history of installing like a Pella.
Now, others is what your information you got from Ken Lango and,
well,
and Evo World and
some came from Mesa.
From NYSERDA.
There was a consultant that reviewed.
So you did actually seek out people for assistance.
The process.
Which you did. So you talked to NYSERDA, you talked to Mesa. So you talked to the person who makes the equipment.
Evo.
To makes the equipment. You talked to NYSERDA about the whole biomass system.
And there's a
So you consulted reputable people and places in order to come up with the numbers you gave us.
To the best we could, yes.
So all that, the consulting with the knowledgeable people and everything, we still have wrong numbers.
But when you bid something out, that's the only, like you could list your house for sale. You
how much contingency
know what it is until
a,
people make bids. That's
how much contingency
price.
Was put in the bid?
10%.
In the actual bid document, there was $20,000 of like allowances for like unforeseen, you know, circumstances.
There was no 10% contingency or 20% contingency?
When we gave the 986, that included a 10%.
10%.
Yeah, and we you know, we'd outlined 10, 15, and 20% like contingency. Or maybe it was...
Yeah, it was 10, 15,
was
and 20.
10, maybe it was just 10 and 15%. So we gave like numbers for 10% contingency and for like a 15% contingency. And the town chose.
But basically what they did, I mean, they said, you know, put bids out for a heating system with two oil boilers, for a hydronic heating system, for two oil boilers and a pellet boiler. And it was up to the people who actually bid on the project to come in with real numbers. I mean, they're the ones that came in with the real numbers.
So, and like I said, we had a conversation with like a few of them, asked them about certain things, about, you know, changing out this, not doing this, and hence that's basically why we wrote our letter. I mean, to, you know, significantly reduce the cost, if you want to try to get to the 986, that's what we have to do.
So based on a lack of knowledge of the pricing of the pellet system, the town will be essentially forced into going to an oil system and paying for potentially significantly higher fuel costs for the life of the entire system, which was what the point of going towards a pellet system was to avoid for the town, is future decades of paying high oil costs.
Well,
and
right.
That's just a sad thing.
Well, we'll actually save in energy cost going from steam to the hot water or the hydronic system.
Right.
I mean, there's a
high efficiency. There's going to be high efficiency.
High efficiency and cost savings to them.
You know, Gretchen, I just want to say, I mean, you know, lack of knowledge
of the pricing.
Yeah, but it's not a lack of knowledge on, you know, our part. I mean, I didn't say it was.
Okay, I was very careful not to.
Okay, I just want to be clear because, you know, I'm not, you know, again, we've been doing this for a long time and we have a good track record. So, you know, there were some unknowns here because of certain things that haven't been done a lot. And, you know, we're just as upset as like you. We don't like to see jobs come in over, you know, the budget. We want to design stuff. We want to see it, you know, built. And we built like hundreds and hundreds of projects, and we want to build this one. But you know, we are where we are, and we're here to try to figure out a way. If we're gonna go rebid this job, you know, I told the other supervisor that we want to help out and that I will eat the cost of, you know, the rebate because we want to go, you know, help out, you know. Some of it was, you know, some of our numbers were like a little bit low on some of the other items. I don't think it was, you know, like great, but we want to help out. So I'm going to eat the cost of, you know, the rebate. So, and that's fine because, you know, we've done work for the town for the year. So, that's where we are.
Are there other options other than oil that you think might be accomplishable with the budget we have?
Unfortunately, gas would be a great natural gas would have been a great option, but it's not available here. We had looked at that very early on. So. I'm not sure if there's anything else you had in mind that I'm missing.
I think the more information, the better. So we'll have two different scenarios. And if it comes in like you are hoping to be $300,000 less, then we're a lot closer to our bonded amount, right? $300,000 is what we need to make up, more or less.
So
I would make a motion that we go ahead and rebid it and get some more information so that we can make an informed decision about comparing the overall cost of these two different scenarios.
I'm not sure what you're doing.
We would be
rebidding
the project with three oil-fired and
okay.
replacing the
pellet.
No, the right. We wouldn't use the pellet, but using the fin, whatever you call those.
Well, what we could do too on that is we could always bid that as an alternate, and we could see what, you know, the fin tubes
right.
would be versus, you know, the radius. So you can see, you know, the difference in the prices, and then you have, you know, the choice. You know, depending on what the bids come in, you have a choice then.
Okay, yes. Or what are we losing as far as the radiant versus the fin tubes?
You'll probably notice mostly aesthetics, but the radiant panels have more radiant heat, where the fin tube is more convective. But you may not notice it.
I mean, visual aesthetic or the comfort
yeah,
level?
Yeah, the radiant panels just it's a nicer looking
okay.
insulation.
I mean, we can send out like some photographs. We can send like a PDF out if you want to like circulate. Again, we're gonna get prices on
right.
you know both.
Right.
So, but we can send out like a PDF and you can you know circulate and so you can see what the difference is.
Okay. Second.
Councilman DeLango.
No.
Councilman Gutierrez.
Yes.
Councilman Hitzelberger.
No.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll, we want to get this back out quickly. I didn't bring a calendar, but I think when we talk to the supervisor, your meetings will be your second May meeting. I think we talked about...
Well, I wanted to see if we could have a special meeting next week, not only for that, but for other reasons.
I think it was the week after your, you know, your regular meeting in May, the second meeting.
Well, I don't know. When would we need to?
Why don't
you let me know?
Yeah, why don't I let you know? Because I think before we had the bids out for 4 weeks, I don't think we need to do it because most of the guys are going to, you know, pick it up again. What we typically do is...
And we might have more.
Yeah, and, you know, the folks that already had picked up the bids, you know, most towns typically, if we're going to rebid, they will not charge them again to pick up, you know, the new bid. So anybody that picked up before will be able to pick up at no additional, cost. So
you think 2 weeks is plenty?
Let me look at, you know, the schedule, you know, to get as many
and
like.
And the county will let us use Empire BidNet again.
I will talk to them again. They will. I'm sure that they will. That'll get it out to, you know, a wider, you know, range people. So.
Okay.
So let me look at, you know, the calendar, and I'll talk to you tomorrow on that, and you know, we'll go from there. Were you going to act on the asbestos bid, or is that separate, or?
Well, we were going to do a resolution.
Okay.
On that later.
Okay.
And also, while you're here, we need to talk about, get an idea of what we need to do with the sidewalk, because we need to go out to bid for that also.
Yes.
I read your letter. I met with Stan this morning, and we looked at the part of the sidewalk that needs to be repaired. The sidewalk that goes from
the blacktop sidewalk part.
The blacktop part. You know, we have a sidewalk that goes from the light on Route 44 to there's a Route 44 sign, and it's at that point it's where it's blacktop.
Yep.
So we measured off from there to 5308 Route 44 driveway, and it's 288 feet. And I think we should be able to repair that part of the sidewalk area, because that's just before the drainage problem.
That's just before you get to the funeral home,
right? It's just after it.
Just after that, okay.
And because it's right at the first catch basin. We measured the area that, you know, that goes to Broadway and all the way down to Beekman Park.
Mm-hmm.
And there's 950 feet, which means if we replace the drainage that DOT wants us to replace, we'd have to put in 950 feet of pipe and four catch basins. Well, that was approximate cost of $400,000, which we don't have. Now, I did meet with Andy and Stan and Ann Saylor from the county.
Mm-hmm.
She said that we explained the problem we had, that there was all this drainage, all the drains were in disrepair. The DOT had no plan to do them in the very near future.
Right.
The town certainly couldn't afford to do them. So she said that the county would allow the town to use part of the grant to do as much of the repair that we could do.
Phasing, right.
And phase it in.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks to me that we should be able to do this 288 feet, which won't require curbs or drains. It starts at Route 44 sign to 5308 Route 44 driveway. There's four driveways, and then I think there's a post and rail fence that you were gonna put up along there.
Yeah, that's the section by the park.
No.
That's the only place where there was.
That was the only place you're gonna put. All right, then
right, because
there won't
you have
be
you know the drop off down there to the
okay.
swale.
So there's a section from the Route 44 sign to 5308 Route 44, and it comes just before the first catch basin.
Yep.
That we should use the grant to repair, because that's the area of the sidewalk that we've had complaints, and we've had a letter from an attorney
mm-hmm.
over the years. So if that's the part that we want to do. We don't want to deal with the alternate route where we'd have to cut multiple trees and it would be farther in from the right of way.
Right.
That isn't something the town wants to do. What we basically want to do is repair sidewalk, and repair sidewalk that we can repair without having to pay extra money for curbs
and
drains.
So just do the section of the repair, and then that would be it. Then you wouldn't think about going further down to the park.
No. Well, if we go down further down to the park, that's an additional cost.
Oh yeah.
So we have to you know, I think we need, what we need to do, the whole point of the grant was to repair the sidewalk. So we need to repair as much as the sidewalk we can without having to deal with the drainage problem.
Okay.
Which the county said we could do. She said we could use all or part of the grant to repair as much as we can without having to deal with the curbs and the drainage.
Okay.
And if everybody's in agreement with that, to just do the 288 feet and not deal with the additional cost of the drains and the curbs and cutting down trees.
Cutting trees.
So we're not cutting trees. So I make,
right.
I make a motion to authorize the repair of 288 feet of sidewalk on Route 44 with the Community Development Block Grant funds.
And to bid them out, right?
And bid it out, because we need to bid it out.
All right, so, sorry, go ahead and vote, sorry.
Second.
Councilman Delango?
No.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Aye.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
And Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Okay, so we would have to revise the plan and just get the county planning department to sign off on that. And then, you know, the DOT would have to sign off on that too, which, you know, is not, is, I mean, they're not gonna have a problem with it, so.
No, we're not fixing anything of theirs. And, oh, they shouldn't have a problem with it. You know, it needs to be repaired.
Okay. All right, well, I will speak to Andy in the morning about that. We'll get that.
And Stan has marked it. He had his orange paint with it.
I am gonna stop and look at it. It's still, you know, light enough.
Yeah, he marked the beginning and the end of it, so it's all marked off.
Well, the beginning is obvious where,
yeah,
where it's gonna start.
Well, the, you know, he marked it both,
yeah,
places, so
okay,
you can see.
All right, I'll stop and look on the way out.
Okay.
Okay, and then I will give you a call in the morning about, you know, the scheduling.
Okay.
All right.
Before you go,
sure,
what's up with the fuel system?
I don't know, honestly. Stan had called me, I think in February, and there was, he had a concern about, you know, reconciling the fuel, because at that time he was trying to reconcile the fuel quantity between the fuel master and the pumps. Because when we put out the bid for him, he had went and got two prices from, you know, from contractors, and they gave him like a list of things that they were going to put in, the type of pumps and all this stuff. So I said, look, you know, you're going to have to go put it out for bid. You just can't, you know, hire somebody. So give me the specs of what you want, and then I'll write like a bid around it. Because we had just done, it was a much larger project. We did a fuel tank project for the town of Pauling, which had the fuel master, but they had 5,000 gallon you know, diesel tank and a 3,000 gallon like unleaded tank, which, you know, was shared between the village and other people. So anyways, so I took, you know, what his specs were. Like
Stan
really,
gave you the specs for
Stan
the
gave me the specs for, you know, the pumps and you know, the equipment, and then you know, we put it together, we put it out for bid. And then, you know, they put it in, and they provided, you know, training. You know, the fuel master folks provided, you know, the training. So then Stan called me up, I think it was February, Mike, and he said, I'm having a problem because I'm trying to reconcile between the pumps and, you know, the fuel master. And I said, well, I don't think you can do that, because the fuel master is, you know, is a computer. I mean, that's registering the flow through, you know, the pumps. Now, the type of pumps that were put on, you know, they're not regular, like, gas pumps. They're basically the pumps that you basically put in the top of, you know, the tank and just pump off.
So it's like a farm pump.
I don't want to use the word like a farm pump, but that's probably not a bad word for it. Those are not like calibrated at the same you know, level as, you know, the Fuel Master system. So what I suggested, and we had talked, because there was, you know, a concern because the one year maintenance bond that we had for the project was going to like expire. So I contacted, you know, the company like who put it in, because I didn't know if there was a problem. So, you know, they came out, you know, we talked on the phone, they came out and met, you know, with Stan, they went through like a bunch of things. And at the time it was, I think on like 500 gallons of fuel or something like that, there was like a 4 gallon like difference between what Stan was recording looking at the pumps and then, you know, the Fuel Master system. So what I suggested is, look, if you want to do, and you know, the people that did, you know, the system said, look, just go by what, you know, the Fuel Master says. That's the most accurate. So I suggested to him, look, if you want to do some kind of a cross check, why don't you just take your delivery tickets, know, you know, the date on when you got one, when your next like fill up is, all right, and in between that period, whatever, you used, you know, 400 gallons, then go to, you know, the Fuel Master and see in that same like period what, you know, the Fuel Master is saying. So you got, you know, the tickets from the delivery truck. I said, if you want to cross check it, you know, most, you know, I don't think most people do like a cross check. You have the fuel, you know, like management system. Now, if there's a problem with the Fuel Master itself, I mean, you know, before, you know, Victoria was talking this evening, that's the first time that I've heard about it since he called like in February, and he was just going to say, okay, that's, you know, like, I'll try that. So
is there, what type of pumps were bid out for this project?
I'd have to get the exact, I don't remember the exact
type. Because you said they were farm pumps?
Well, I mean, we call, you know, Mike calls it a farm pump. I mean, you know, a lot of people call it a farm pump, but they were the pumps that were, that, you know, the two contractors who gave Stan quotes before we put it out for bid, you know, because Stan wasn't sure how much it was going to be. So once it went over a certain, you know, dollar amount, I think we ended up spending, I don't know, 30-something, you know, $1,000 for the...
Would it have made a difference with the accuracy if there had been different pumps?
I don't think so, because down, you know, in Pauling, we put in, you know, the calibrated pumps, because again, they pump a lot of, you know, of fuel. Again, they have 5,000 gallon tank and a 3,000 gallon tank, and they had the regular, you know, gas boy pumps, like, you know, you would pull up, not quite like you would pull up to like a gas station, but they have those type of a pumps on like an island. And again, it's totally like different, but those were probably $25,000. So, you know, it was, you know, why put the $25,000 pumps in when you're only, I think we have a, what, like a 1,000 gallon like diesel, and I think it's, I don't know, 500 gallon like unleaded or something like that. So to put in, you know, $15,000 or $20,000 in really fancy pumps when you're already getting like a Fuel Master computerized system that is supposed to record, you know, the fuel use, it just doesn't make sense to put in, you know, fancy, you know, pumps. And I believe that that's why the two, you know, the two guys who had given Stan, you know, the quotes, they both had the same type of, you know, farm pump, you know, we'll call it.
Instead of the more expensive pumps.
Right, because it was like a dollar and cents thing. We're only talking about a 1,000 gallon tank and a 500 gallon tank, and you were going to get, you know, the Fuel Master system anyways. So why spend a lot more money on the pumps to try to go like cross check what your, you know, fancy Fuel Master computerized, you know, system's supposed to do for you? So until, you know, you read this tonight, that's the first time that I heard he was still having issues with it. So I would call, you know, the fuel. I mean, I'll give him a call in the morning. I mean, but it seems like he's already called somebody in, and I'd like to find out.
Well, he's called somebody in, and I believe that person is going to look to see if anything needs recalibration. So
I don't know if it's something with, you know, the Fuel Master is not like reading right.
Yeah, well, we
sure
need to get to the bottom of it, because we need to have, this needs to be accurate.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they come out when they do, you know, their training. I guess, again, without, you know, talking to them, I don't know what the issue is with, you know, the accuracy, but maybe the fuel master needs, you know, to be calibrated. So they haven't.
Well, I believe that's.
There hasn't been any issues.
Why this other person is going to take a look at it?
We've had the one operational in Pauling for probably 2 years now, and everything's working fine. It must be something with, you know, the fuel master that needs to be, you know, recalibrated or something. But I'll give him a call in the morning. It's the first time I've heard of it.
Okay. Does anyone else have any other questions? I think we should go ahead and do the resolution. Oh, did you?
Let me just get the name from Pete. I'm reading on the Empire bid when they advertise and
This
is the one that we got today.
Yeah.
Which version? Is it the one that we got right before the board meeting or the one that was in the packets?
See, I have to go back and look at it was in March. It was very, very early in March because the bids were available.
So which version are we?
Bids were available on March 11th, and we took bids one month after. So it had to be.
Options. Which
it had
one
to be
should
the
I read?
first week in March, March 4th, 5th. I can look on my emails and I'll have it.
The one that has a font.
No, I don't have it.
Like
I don't have it right here.
The funky font?
The funky font.
All righty.
There you go, funky font.
Yeah, I can give you another
read
date
it now.
Tomorrow. Yeah, it's a little retroactive handwriting. Come on, a little retroactive. But it was early March,
why
Denise.
Did we get
it was
so
that
late?
First. It was that first, you know, week in March.
We were supposed to get this stuff on Monday.
I know that.
So
I know that for sure. I just don't know
Victoria.
The exact date.
What?
Why did we get this so late?
You wanted to know why we got it so late.
Yeah.
Well, you got it before, but there was one change that Pete had in the third whereas paragraph where the word performance bond was changed to bid bonds. But this was sent to you with the performance bond in it. And I sent you an email about the correction.
That was early on in the week. I think it was Monday because, you know, I was copied on it too. And you know, I responded.
Well, we're supposed to receive all of our documents and the agenda by noon on Mondays prior to the meetings. That's why I was asking the supervisor why we didn't.
Well, this was.
This was sent.
This was sent, but it had a.
I received this at 6:55 tonight.
But there's one word changed. If you prefer to go back to the prior version, we can use that and handwrite in the change. But it's one word that is changed in it.
Yeah, that email was sent around Monday morning, I believe, from you to all the board members and myself.
Mm-hmm. And the change was noted.
Which one do you want to do?
Well, I'm reading through the one I got at 6:55 tonight, so just give me a second.
So Denise, the only difference is the removal of performance bonds in the third whereas?
It's not the removal. Performance bonds was changed to bid bonds. It's just the word performance was changed to bid.
Got it.
But I had sent the email with, you know, Pete's comment about that one change. So if you prefer to go back to the version that was sent out earlier, we can just hand write in the change in the one word.
Was this bid specific in any way to the intent of the original project? I'm sorry, this all kind of predates me and I'm catching up, but what I'm getting at is, because it's likely that the ultimate project would change, would the work
No,
that they...
No, it would have zero effect. No, because all that was for, that was just going to be in the area where, you know, the piping was going to be put in, nothing to do with, you know, the boilers or anything like that. It was just going to be where, it's going to be down in, you know, the tunnels, some of the old, like, tunnels. When they took, before the town took over this building, the school district came in and did an asbestos abatement project. And it was, I'm not sure how this happened, but there was some areas of asbestos that were still left in the tunnels, you know, like dust, you know, basically. So just in the areas where they're going to run new piping for this project, we have to just go in and, for lack of a better word, you know, vacuum it up. And then also in some of the rooms that have the vinyl floor tile, you know, we tested the vinyl floor tile, and it is asbestos. So just where they're going to make a penetration up through the floor to put, you know, a 2-inch pipe or so, we just have to take out like a few tiles right in an area where they're going to make that pipe penetration. So it has to be done. It would have to be done anyways, no matter whether it was a pellet boiler or an oil-fired boiler. So it doesn't have any effect on it. Hopefully that's what your question was.
Yeah. Thanks. And any rough estimate as to what the third-party air monitoring might cost? I mean, I know this bid came in on the budget,
I have to get some prices, but, I mean, we budgeted, you know, 25 for this. I can't see it being anywhere, you know, near another, like, 8,000 to make our 25. I just don't think it's going to be that much. But I'll get some prices.
All right, sorry, and last question. If the option to go with the fin tube versus radiant, would that change the location of any of the remediation that needs to be done? No.
All right,
I'm good. Cool. I'll make a motion to.
You want to read the resolution?
Oh, geez. Am I signing up for that?
You got to get your number.
Making your first motion.
Yes.
Everybody know.
No, he's reading the resolution.
He's going to do his first read. Resolution number? It's going to be 17.
Well, okay, hold on. Do I have to read the exhibit too? Because.
No, you get to skip
the resolution. So you get to start and say, and what resolution?
18?
17. Oh, you're so close. Which one are you reading? Which version?
It's the one with the funny...
The funny font.
The funky font, yeah.
Header.
Thanks.
The one that Unless, you would you prefer to do the original one we received on Monday and make the one-word change?
I just wanted to know what I was supposed to read. I received it so late, I just wanted to make sure.
The wrong extension.
It was confusing to have two.
I didn't...
Yeah.
It was on the menu. Do you need to change what you have? This must have come from the presentation.
Yeah. Okay, you ready?
I am.
Okay. Start reading.
Resolution 17 of 2016, resolution accepting bid of and awarding contract for Town of Amenia Town Hall Asbestos Removal Project to the lowest responsible bidder, ATEC Group LLC. Whereas the Town of Amenia caused a legal notice entitled Notice to Contractors Soliciting Bids for the Town of Amenia Town Hall Asbestos Removal Project to be published in the Millerton News, the town's official newspaper, on March 10th, 2016, and on the Empire Bid Net website on...
We're going, we can put in early March.
Scratch on in early March 2016. In the form annexed hereto as Exhibit A, and the town further caused a copy of said legal notice to be posted on the town's official town clerk bulletin board located in the Town of Amenia Town Hall, 4988 Route 22, Amenia, New York, on March 4th, 2016, and sealed bids submitted in response to said legal notice for the Town of Amenia Town Hall Asbestos Removal Project were opened at the Amenia Town Hall on April 11th, 2016, in the presence of the town clerk, Robert Travis of Morris Associates Engineering and Surveying Consultants, PLLC, and various members of the public in attendance, at which time Robert Travis announced the names of the bidders, the subject upon which the bids were submitted, and the amounts of the bids, as well as the inclusion of a non-collusive statement, the bid form, and the bid bonds or checks. And the bids submitted at that time for the asbestos removal project were as follows: Asbestos Corp. of America, Yonkers, New York, amount $24,100. ATEC Group, LLC, Fairfield, New Jersey, amount $17,140. Jupiter Environmental, Pine Brook, New Jersey, amount $38,600. NSC Abatement Services, Incorporated, Mount Vernon, New York, amount $57,500. And subsequent to the submission of such bids, the bids were reviewed by Morris Associates, the engineering firm retained by the Town of Armenia with respect to the design, plan, and specifications for the Town Hall Heating System Replacement Project and the Asbestos Removal Project, and a report was made to the Town Board by Morris Associates. And the Town Board has given due consideration to the bid submitted for the Asbestos Removal Project and the report issued by Morris Associates to the Town Board. Now, therefore, be it resolved that after review, the due consideration of all the foregoing, the Town Board hereby, 1, accepts the bid of ATEC Group, LLC of Fairfield, New Jersey, the lowest responsible bidder for the asbestos removal project in the amount of $17,140, and 2, awards the contract for the asbestos removal project to ATEC Group, LLC of Fairfield, New Jersey, subject to the proper execution of the contract and return of 4 complete executed copies of the contract to the town attorney, Denise M. Fitzpatrick, Esquire, 43 Bennett Common Way, Millbrook, New York, 12545, with a complete copy provided to the town's retained engineer, Morris Associates Engineering and Surveying Consultants, PLLC, 9 Elks Lane, Poughkeepsie, New York, 845-454-3411. Together with a performance bonds insurance certificate as required by said contract, certificates of insurance as required by said contract, comprehensive asbestos removal schedule, list of all manpower types and equipment to be used on the project, and further specifications outlined by the town's retained engineer, Morris Associates, in its notice of award provided to said contractor. All of the same to be submitted within...
You had recommended, I think, 21 days. 15
yeah.
business days or 21
days
that gives you sufficient.
Yeah, that's fine.
So
21 days.
Within 21 days from the date of the notice of award provided by Morris Engineers to ATEC Group, LLC, and upon approval of the town attorney and the town's retained engineering firm, Morris Associates, of such contract as executed by ATEC Group, LLC, and of all the required submissions therewith, authorizes the town supervisor, Victoria Perotti, to execute said contract on behalf of the town board of the town of Armenia. Motions made by...
So you made the motion?
Me, P. Damian Gutierrez.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Vicki Doyle.
When Dawn takes over now.
No, we'll let him go.
Done?
He's doing so
I'm
well.
Yeah. He can't do it.
I know. Let's see. Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Councilman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilman Delango?
Yes.
And Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Okay, so what I'll do is tomorrow I will send them a notice of award of the project, and then I will coordinate all the bonds and the insurance and, you know, the contracts with them. Once I have that information back, then I'll forward it to the town, and yourself, you can check the bond, and assuming everything is all right, then a supervisor would countersign the contract, and then I send the contract back to them with a notice to proceed, and then we'll supervise the work. So okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Peter or Bob, so tomorrow I'll go ahead and contact all of the bidders for both projects, letting them know that there's been no decision on the first, and then who's been awarded on the second. So that'll answer all of our emails and phone calls?
Yes.
And you'll email that to me. Because once you email it to me, then I can email it directly. Okay.
Resolution number 18?
Yes.
Resolution for standard work day and reporting for New York State and local employees' retirement system. A meeting of the town board of the town of Armenia, held at the Armenia Town Hall on the 17th day of March, 2016, at 7:30 p.m. Town Supervisor Victoria Ferrari called the meeting to order. And I make that motion. Second. Aye. I need a second.
I'll second it.
Introduce the following resolution to it. Whereas it is required by the New York State Employees Retirement System that all active employees and elected and appointed officials participating in the retirement system have a locally established standard workday for the purposes of reporting retirement credit. Whereas the town of Armenia has active full-time and part-time employees and elected and appointed officials who participate in the New York State Employees Retirement System. Now therefore, be it resolved that the town board hereby adopts the following as standard work days for active full-time and part-time employees and elected and appointed officials will report the following day's work to New York State and locals' employees' retirement system. Highway laborers, machine, equipment operator, 8 hours, working foreman, 8 hours, town clerk, 6 hours, deputy town clerk, 6 hours, secretary of the supervisor, 6 hours, typist, 6 hours, building inspector, 6 hours, constable, 6 hours, summer camp director, 6 hours, all other elected or appointed officials, 6 hours. Foregoing resolution was voted upon with all council persons voting as follows.
Supervisor Perotti.
Yes.
Councilwoman Doyle.
Yes.
Councilman Hetzelberger.
Yes.
Councilman Delango.
Yes.
Councilman Gutierrez.
Yes.
And Silo Ridge Eastmans and resolutions. Denise.
Do you want to address the HOA resolution first, I would suggest?
Okay, just the one on the top then. So the resolution authorizing to approve the LLC Homeowners Association, right. Is that what we're doing? So resolution number 19. Resolution authorizing town attorney to approve Silo Ridge Ventures property, a LLC Homeowners Association documents, whereas Silo Ridge Ventures property, a LLC, is the owner of 670 plus or minus acres of real property located in the town of Armenia, which Silo intends to develop as a mixed-use resort community to be known as Silo Ridge Field Club. Whereas in 2013, Silo Ridge Ventures LLC as applicant applied to the town of Armenia Planning Board for, among other things, one, an amended special permit master development plan approval for the project, two, special permit approvals for the golf maintenance facility, golf course improvements and wastewater plant, three, site plan approval for the first phase of the project, four, preliminary subdivision approval and lot line adjustment to incorporate a portion of the HVLC property into the project site, five, certain waivers and supplementary approvals under the zoning code and subdivision code. Whereas on March 25th, 2014, the Planning Board circulated a full environmental assessment form for the project to all involved agencies, including the Town Board of the Town of Armenia. And on May 15, 2014, the Planning Board designated itself as lead agency under the State Environmental Quality Review Act for review of the applications for the project, whereas as part of the applications, applicant Silo submitted an addendum to the EAF containing numerous detailed and thorough plans, reports, studies, and other documents evaluating the project's potential impacts on environmental and other sources. Whereas on August 21st, 2014, the Planning Board determined the applications complete for purposes of public review, and on September 4, 2014, September 18, 2014, and May 5, 2015, the Planning Board held duly noticed public hearings on the applications and supplemental secret materials, whereas the Planning Board, with the assistance of its ecological, planning, engineering, visual, and legal consultants, thoroughly reviewed the EAF, the applications, revised supplemental secret materials to identify the relevant areas of environmental concern, and thoroughly analyzed the identified areas of environmental concern to determine if the project may have a significant adverse impact on the environment. Whereas on July 29, 2015, the Planning Board adopted resolution number 8 of 2015 entitled resolution adopting an amended and restated finding statements under SEAKER for the Silo Ridge Field Club. Whereas on July 29, 2015, the Planning Board also adopted the following resolutions, among others, in connection with the project: 1, Resolution Number 9 of 2015, titled Resolution Approving the Amended Special Permit and Amended Master Development Plan for the Silo Ridge Field Club; 2, Resolution Number 11, titled Resolution Approving Lot Line Adjustment and Preliminary Subdivision Plat for the Silo Ridge Field Club; and 3, Resolution Number 12 of 2015, titled Resolution Approving Site Plans for Phase 1 of the Silo Ridge Field Club. Whereas the Town Board of the Town of Amenia is an involved agency for the project under SEAKER because the board has jurisdiction by law to approve certain aspects of the project. Whereas on November 19, 2015, after careful review of the amended SEAKER findings prepared by the Planning Board, the Town Board adopted Resolution Number 44 of 2015, adopting the SEAKER finding statement for the Silo Ridge Field Club in accordance with 6 NYCRR 617.11, and whereas as part of the project, Silo intends to develop a residential community, including lots to be improved with single-family detached homes and or townhomes, residential condominium units and multiple condominium developments, a hotel, condominium, or other permitted residential developments or any mixture thereof, for various common facilities, whereas Silo has expressed its intention to provide for the preservation of the values and amenities of the project, for the maintenance of the common facilities thereof, and to that end desires to subject the project property or portions thereof to certain covenants, restrictions, easements, charges, and liens as set forth in a declaration of covenants, restriction, easements, charges, and liens, association bylaws, and rules and regulations of the association being Silo Ridge Homeowners Association Incorporated, a not-for-profit corporation organized under the not-for-profit corporation law of the state of New York, the stated purpose of exercising the functions and powers of maintaining and administering the subject property and improvements thereon, enforcing the covenants and restrictions on said property, collecting and dispersing assessments and charges on said property. Whereas to this end, Silo has submitted to the Town of Amenia the proposed declaration of covenants, restrictions, easements, charges, liens, association bylaws, and rules and regulation of the Silo Ridge Homeowners Association Incorporated in the form annexed hereto as Exhibit A. Whereas the Town Code of the Town of Amenia at Chapter 105, entitled Subdivision of Land, Article 6, entitled Performance Guarantees for Major Subdivisions, Section 105-27B, provides for the Town Attorney's review and approval of Homeowners Association documents and restrictions and covenants to be adopted by the Homeowners Association in connection with a subdivision to assure that such provisions are in furtherance of the provisions of Chapter 105. Whereas the Town of Amenia Planning Board conditioned its preliminary subdivision plat approval on the Town's review of the Homeowners Association documents in Condition 20 of the 5th Resolve Clause of Resolution Number 11 of 2015, adopted July 29, 2015, where the Planning Board required that the final Homeowners Association documents be submitted to the Planning Board and the Town Attorney for review and approval as required by Section 105-27 of the Subdivision Law of the Town Code. Whereas the Town Attorney has consulted with the Town Planning Board Attorney with respect to review of the Homeowners Association documents submitted by Silo as required by the Town Code and the Town Planning Board Resolution Number 11 of July 29, 2015, and certain revisions have been made by Silo so as to comply with said requirements. Now, therefore, be it resolved that after review and due consideration of all of the foregoing, the Town Board hereby authorizes the Town Attorney to approve the Homeowners Association documents. And I make that motion.
Second that.
Discussion?
Okay.
When the Town Code and the Homeowners Association Code are at odds, and the Town
Homeowners Association Code,
the rules and regulations of the Homeowners Association, when there's a discrepancy where the Town is more restrictive than the Homeowners Association, if that became a problem, would the town code be enforced, or would the homeowners association code be
enforced? You would have to point out the provision. I mean, you'd have to show me in the HOA documents specifically what you're talking about, and then we'd have to look at the code.
Well, for example, our zoning code says fencing is 4 feet. The homeowners association rules and regulations say 6 feet, which would have precedence, Denise.
Well, it may be because it's on private property within, you know, that community. I don't know. I would have to look at it. I'd have to look at it specifically.
Could you take a look and get back to me and let me know that?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
If I may provide a little explanation on that. Actually, the typical item like that is actually not managed by the HOA. The HOA documents is more providing the maintenance and rules and regulations, how you maintain all the public open spaces in the...
It's on page 6, Pedro. That's why I asked.
They're in compliance with what the zoning that was created for our property, the RDO. So they have to enforce what's on the master development plan that was approved by the planning board. So they're in compliance already, because what they're enforcing is what's being approved. That's what I was trying to say. So it can be where the zone is different than what they will be enforcing, because essentially they will be enforcing what's being already approved by the town and planning board.
What is the page that you're referring
page
to?
Page 6.
Page 6 of which?
The Homeowners Association Rules and Regulations. Paragraph JJ.
I have to get back to you.
Thank you.
What's the question, though?
If there's a discrepancy between the Homeowners Association rules and regulations and the town code, which takes precedence?
So your thing is JJ, fences or walls in the rear yard of a Class A member's lot, which are located on the joint property line, will require the approval of the adjacent lot of the Class A member to the rear. Fence height is limited to a maximum of 6 feet.
Right, but our code says 4 feet. That's just an example. So what Pedro said was that when they went through the planning process, apparently they have a waiver for their property, so it's 6 feet there, which is totally fine. You know, people have that happen during the planning process all the time. It's just a generic question of which takes precedence when there's a discrepancy. And Denise will get back to us on it, so that'll be great, and I appreciate it.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the resolution.
Motion's been made and seconded. I just need to take roll call. We're at discussion.
Okay.
Any other discussion?
Go ahead.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilman Delango?
Yes.
And Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Are we ready for the, any of the others?
Well, there is an issue. There were some changes made this week in the area of the conservation easements. There were some acreage changes.
Yeah, so like, let me explain a little what happened. Unfortunately, as frustrated as you might be, I'm the same. There were some minor changes that were done to the maintained conservation easement. Those were, there were some comments provided by town consultants on Tuesday. Those required a couple minor changes on the plan. It did not change the overall conservation easement area or how the way it works. What ended up happening is we had, in the previous maps, we had, I believe there was 8 restored areas. And John Andrews, the town engineer, felt that it was a mistake to have those as restored areas, because the goal for restored was that we're going to turn into natural areas thereafter. And his concern was that there's utilities that go through, you know, some of those areas have utility lines in close proximity. So his concern would be 20 years from now, someone needs to go do work on to fix a water line or fix a drainage line that is in there. And the natural conservation easement is pretty strict in terms of what you can do in those areas. So we ended up modifying those. Denise suggested today that some of the plans were a little small, so I brought some bigger plans, a copy for each member, just so.
But the thing is, the change.
So those changes were submitted, I think, yesterday. And I know we've been waiting for this all along. So my main concern is, for us, time is of essence. With conservation easement was supposed to be completed on, you know, between us and the planning board 2 months ago. And we keep on going, making changes after things have been agreed, changes after things have been agreed. And you know, it's starting to have a diverse effect on the development of the site at the moment. And you know, I'm happy to walk you through those changes. If you have any questions, walking through it. And you know, but my main concern is the planning board has set a meeting for next Tuesday to try to, you know, they were hoping that this would have been approved today, or it gets approved today, and then them executing documents next Tuesday. I'm afraid, you know, how this will work or not work. So, but I'm here to see what the town board wants to do and any questions they have and so forth.
Victoria, did David Everett have a chance to review the modifications to the conservation easement?
Yes, he did.
They came from him.
Signed off.
They came from him.
The problem is there's a change in the acreage in the maintained and the restored areas. And my understanding is what you're saying is Mr. Andrews wanted a certain portion taken out of the restored areas, correct, and put in the maintained.
Yes, yeah, so I'll show you.
The maintained increased.
So let me show you the map. I need a microphone. It's up to you. Okay. So page one, you have one. You can actually use it.
Pedro, is there a difference between these two?
One is the maintained, and one is the maintained, and one's the natural. The overall plan stays the same, so the changes wouldn't change specific to each one of them. So,
got it.
If you see this little sliver here, this little sliver, that was supposed to be a restored area. If you see this little section here, that before was a restored area. If you see this sliver here, that was a restored area. This sliver here, that sliver, and that sliver. So John Andrews' concern is, for example, in this three, is there utility lines that are next to the roads.
Yeah, there's little things here.
Okay.
Yeah. So those are, there's utilities that are next to the roads. And part of the reason we had them as restored is when we were going to build the road, there was going to be disturbance in that area. After the road's built, we really are not doing anything there. So the goal was, hey, let's turn it natural. And his concern was, well, the maintain area allows you to turn it natural, but still gives you the opportunity that if a pipe breaks or you need to go fix that, you can do that, whether the natural area is extremely prohibited. So he made us modify those and put them in the maintained conservation easement. They're still on the overall acreage, but those are the changes that were made. So it would be those slivers there, this sliver here, the sliver here. So if you want, let me, do you have a...
Does one say maintain on the top?
Yeah, if you go in the detailed ones, you'll see which ones there are. But they're page by page. I can call it one here if you want.
This was a recommendation by the town's consultant to make these changes?
Yeah, it was done actually last week Wednesday, and we were supposed to get it by Friday. Unfortunately, we didn't get these comments until Tuesday. So that's what ended up driving this.
And that's the only change?
These are the, and then we had to track this on the verbiage. So the verbiage had to track that stuff. So David made all those changes on Tuesday, I think, and he sent it out on Wednesday.
I don't know, but
I believe Wednesday he sent
it out. So I know in the package you dropped off at Town Hall yesterday, this pertained to the maintained and the restored areas.
Mm-hmm.
And you changed, the acreage has changed in the
easement
itself, and it's changed in the map that was attached to that. The
correct.
Problem is, well, first of all, Did the engineer amend the meets and bounds description of each area?
Exhibit A. We didn't have to change it. They're the same meets and bounds. Because those stayed the same. It's just instead of being called restored area one, they're called maintained area two and maintained area three.
Right, which is
but all the meets and bounds stay the same. We still have the same meets and bounds for all those individual lots.
Right, but you still would have to change if they're no longer in the restored area, they're in the maintained.
Yeah, that was changed. Yeah, Peter made those changes.
Change that?
Yeah, they made all those changes.
Did you change it in the exhibit?
Correct.
Okay. And then the problem is on the easement for the natural area.
They were done in both.
What Julie said today is that the final version is the one that was submitted March 24th. I think the town has stamped it on the 29th maybe. But the problem is the map that's attached as the exhibit,
mm-hmm.
It has the old acreage in the main.
No, the natural conservation easement and the maps will be this for sure.
But that's not what's attached to what I already have.
Of course, because they changed this week. We had to essentially Tuesday we got those changes.
But you changed this one. You changed the main.
No, we changed both of them. We submitted two new ones.
I do.
Otherwise, they were submitted all again yesterday. And then I brought in new ones.
You brought the ones. Yeah, I got the maintained and the restored area. But there's nothing new on the natural area.
Yes, there is.
When we called Tara, called over to Julie today.
I dropped everything again. So they were sent by email yesterday. And they were printed out and submitted today. Unfortunately, that's what
late, like you were.
Yeah, we were struggling to get
them. Yeah, I don't have them. I haven't seen them.
Oh, okay, so they're there.
Well.
So, but those were the changes.
I mean, you know, it's like I get this now, and you know, I don't have the document with the proper attachments.
You only have it digitally. I agree with you.
But I didn't have the exhibits digitally.
The exhibits should have had. They were in there.
I have the easement, but even in the one...
Because all of this was finished yesterday, it's just we had our printer broke. We didn't get it ready until this afternoon.
I mean, I don't have the version of the natural area with the maps as they were revised with the changed acreage.
Okay, I guess you have them here, but yeah. They weren't submitted until today.
Is that what this is?
Yeah, one is for the natural, one's for the... One's for the natural, one's for the...
So those new maps have to be attached to this resolution?
Correct, they would have to be attached.
So this is Exhibit B, and what about the old Exhibit A?
Excuse me? They stay the same. Those all stay the same.
Have they relabeled?
Yes.
Those areas?
Yes.
You're sure?
You have a printout here. So, on whatever, I think, what's the time board secretary's name?
This is the name of the Tara.
Tara put them in, I think, in your folders. Well, we can check if you want.
I completely.
They didn't know.
Yeah, all that was submitted. Actually, part of the reason why the one that we submitted today was Peter also worked on between Tuesday and Wednesday. He worked on creating a final version that could be executed next Wednesday. But.
So did you just deliver the maps this afternoon?
Yeah.
Just the maps?
And then the easements were dropped yesterday, but the printer wasn't working. It's just been.
Because what I don't like to be put in a position of now I have to juggle exhibits around and figure out what's going to be attached, and then it's not correct.
I understand.
You know, the So
quick question on that one, because my understanding is, of course, we need the resolution from the town board, but ultimately, these documents, or what I understood from Peter and David, Peter Weiss, our attorney, and David Everett, was that a set of executable documents will be reviewed on Tuesday next week and then be executed on Wednesday.
Which documents?
All of them. So, because they're going essentially through the easements, the access agreement, all those documents, because for example, the old access agreement had the date from December last year.
Right.
Well, we're going to be recording it now, so we need. They're going through all those documents to make sure we have a final executable document, and then execute. So
right, and there's information that has to be filled in. But you know, correct. My problem tonight is, you know, I'm advising the town board. I can't tell them to approve something that I don't have in final form with the proper exhibits attached to it. I can't pick and choose which exhibits and put it together. That's not, you know, for me to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, what you did, what you delivered.
I understand we're giving it to you right now.
What you delivered yesterday on the maintained and the restored areas, you had the conservation easement and you had attached the new maps with the changed acreage.
Correct.
You had it all there in a package. You delivered the six or whatever copies.
Correct.
But I don't have that in the natural area.
Yeah, because we submitted the maps today on
and,
that.
Yeah, what Julie was telling me is the version submitted on March 24th is it, and it's not because the acreage is the old acreage.
Correct, yeah, no, we submitted those again. The hard copies of those were submitted today.
Okay, this afternoon at 5 o'clock or something.
Yeah, we submitted the digital yesterday, but those we didn't bring into today. You're 100% right. Yeah, no, I understand the position we're in, and it's like, unfortunately, we got those changes on Tuesday. And he went from, you know, they ended up making all those changes.
Okay. The other thing is maybe you want to just explain to the board there's a substituted exhibit F.
Sure. I'll do it.
Which is your page that's sideways.
May I borrow
sure.
this? Okay. So, hello.
So the. John Andrews also had some comments on this plan.
Mm-hmm.
This plan originally had the grading.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason we originally had the grading was the idea behind the shading was to understand not allow trees of certain heights. And so it's based on the elevation of the topography. So yeah, you didn't want a tree that was 20 feet high blocking the view, so you needed to make sure that if you're allowing a tree up to 20 feet, that was 30, 40 feet below the road. So originally we had all the grading. So he requested that we change the grading, or we take the grading out, because the grading was creating some confusion with the hatching. So he made us take that out. And we had also all of our maps, when you review them, our subdivision maps and our have a line that represents the RDO setback on 44. That line was there. He made us take that line out. So Shelley would be easier to read the plan. It was like this before.
Yes, so we'll substitute that.
No, it's okay.
So, you know, I don't know if you're having a special meeting next week or something, but, you know, what I would just recommend is that we get the final package on the other easement, the natural areas, with the appropriate, you know, maps attached.
Are these the maps?
Yeah.
I make a motion that we accept this resolution with the proper maps.
Second.
Well, there's also the meets and bounds, I want verification.
We're in the middle of a vote. We're in the middle of a roll.
No, we're in discussion.
No.
It was seconded.
It was seconded.
I know, after it's second, then we have discussion.
You didn't request a discussion yet, Victoria.
Okay, discussion.
There you go.
Discussion.
So I think we need to verify that the meets and bounds descriptions of each of the areas, while the total acreage will not change, each area should be properly designated if it's been taken out of the restored area and put in the maintained area. We should make sure that that's been done. And then this is Exhibit B.
All the exhibits are on, all the other exhibits are on the package that we delivered today.
Okay, which I don't have it, so.
I think they're in those folders.
I mean, you just have to verify that all the exhibits are the appropriate ones attached to that resolution.
So we could pass the resolution. While requiring the town attorney to make sure all the attachments are correct.
One of the things I was going to suggest that I thought would be a good idea was for Denise to also be on Tuesday when we review all the executable documents, because we have several documents that are from from the town board, the public access agreement and the transportation corporation and those. Since since we're going to have one final set of documents, I think it would be important for Denise also to be there with David and Peter as they go through all those documents before they get executed. And I think at that time, we can also verify to make sure that all the easements and everything else is in there as well.
Yeah, Victoria, I think that's a good way to move it forward.
Has Julie at our engineering company reviewed the meets and bounds?
No, so always she's there.
The meets and bounds wouldn't change. Is the title of
the
parcels,
areas.
Right? Okay. So we had a parcel called Restored Area 2, and you had meets and bounds for that. Now that's going to be called Maintained Area 5.
Okay.
And the same meets and bounds thing.
Don't change,
correct.
Just the titles.
We have to change the titles and all those.
What was your motion? It was to
accept the resolution.
Mm-hmm. Accept the resolutions.
Well, you haven't read it either.
Well, Victoria would want to add on
read it.
With the town lawyer reviewing the...
Making sure that the correct attachments are with the...
Conditional
upon the town attorney
the
making
documents.
Sure the proper documents are attached to the resolution.
Yes.
Okay.
And I will second that revised motion.
You didn't read it, though.
Right, you'd have to read that.
And I hate to say it, but I think...
Town of Armenia Town Board, resolution number...
Hold on, Mike. The other thing is, if everybody can check their packets, because I only have the one resolution here for the natural area. I don't see the one that was supposed to be here for the maintained and restored areas.
We don't have the resolutions.
For the natural, we have natural. She's looking for the 18.
Does everyone have both?
Mm-hmm.
I have natural.
We all have natural.
I mean, it was upstairs today.
It's upstairs?
It was upstairs this afternoon. Tara had it. I think it just somehow got lost in the shuffle.
Well, do you want to take a break? We'll go get it. Because we really should do everything together. Yes.
It's a good idea.
So, Pedro?
Yes.
I felt like we discussed the planning board meeting, so we're going to discuss it here at the town board meeting.
Okay.
I would just ask that Silo Ridge kindly include me on your circulations.
Sure.
As not only as the town clerk, but currently what happened going back 2 years ago, the town board authorized me to enter into a huge grant.
Okay.
With four other surrounding towns. And it happens to be that since you guys have a great project, we're putting you on this parent portal.
Okay.
And currently what's happening is Larissa's copying everything from a recent action.
Okay.
And is giving us the applications. But rather than having to have them, you know, in hand and hard copied, if you just include me on
sure.
your emails, then it'll go right up onto our website. So when items like this are approved, it's going to be sent and it's going to have direct access to
So what I'll do is I'll make sure that Julie puts you in the communication.
I see Julie all the time. She waves at me when she walks by, but she doesn't stop in, so.
No, what I'll do is I'll have her make sure that she puts an extra copy.
Thank you.
And that's not a problem.
Thank you.
Not a problem.
This is the one that's missing. Mm-hmm. If you're going to copy, just erase that.
Mm-hmm. No, not that one. Yeah, but I don't know this one.
That's the front. This is the draft.
Okay.
You making copies?
Do you have a natural?
Yeah, we all have natural.
I do.
I don't.
Oh, you don't.
What do you have in your packets?
You don't have any?
I don't have the resolutions for either of the two conservation easements.
Okay. So take the natural two. Does everyone have the natural?
That's why I look in your packet.
I have the natural.
You did?
You have
yeah,
that's,
natural.
That's what I saw.
Natural.
She has the natural. Okay.
Yeah. That was it's a separate one. Resolution,
need,
right? Yeah. I didn't see it.
Okay, we
but
need
maybe
all the maintained. All the maintained two naturals, Don.
Let me see.
Yeah, it's
getting
just
getting it out of the way. No, that's all homeowners. Oh,
so you have these in email form?
Oh, I do have the conservation as well.
Okay, but you have these on
natural
email session.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. You have your natural?
I do.
So it's just this one.
I need mine.
If it's just one,
yep.
Take it because
okay.
I just need email format.
Okay.
What's this thing?
She doesn't need a backup.
She what?
Doesn't need a backup.
Okay.
Guys, we're ready to get started again and read the resolution.
Resolution number 20/2016. Resolution approving form of conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants. Maintain conservation area and restored conservation area by and between Silo Ridge Ventures property, ALLC owner, and North American Land Trust holder, and the town board of the town of Amenia, and authorizing town supervisor to execute said conservation agreement. The first part of this resolution is everything I just read for the HOA. So I don't think I need to, it's the same as the HOA agreement, so I don't think I need to read again.
Agreed.
Okay, whereas the main, let's see.
Where you can pick up Victoria.
Whereas the maintained, I think.
The subject property, page 2.
Where?
Dan, third paragraph from the bottom.
Okay, whereas the subject property is located in the Resort Development Overlay District, as set forth in the Town of Amenia zoning law, Whereas pursuant to Section 121-18(c)(4) of the zoning law, a minimum of 80% of the total land area covered by a master development plan and located in the RDO district must be preserved by a conservation easement as open space as provided in Section 121-20K of the zoning law. Whereas the project site contains 669.9 acres in the RDO district, and therefore the minimum area of open space that must be preserved pursuant to the zoning law is 535.9 acres. Whereas the land to be preserved as open space is subject to certain limitations on structures and improvements pursuant to Section 121-18(c)(4) and Section 121-20K of the zoning law. Whereas New York State has recognized the importance of efforts to preserve open land in a scenic, natural, and open condition through conservation restrictions by enactment of the New York State Environmental Conservation Law, Article 49, Sections 49-0301, and has declared its policy to preserve and protect the state's lakes, rivers, streams, and ponds by enactment of Title V, Article 15 of New York State ECL. Whereas the Town of Armenia Comprehensive Plan Update, adopted July 19, 2007, prioritizes protection of natural resources and the environment and suggests preservation of open space through the use of conservation easements in order to achieve natural resource protection goals of the Comprehensive Plan Update. Whereas portions of the conservation area fall within all three areas of the Town of Armenia's Scenic Protection Overlay District, the Trail Visual Protection Corridor and the Road Visual Protection Corridor include land lying within 800 feet of the right-of-way of U.S. Route 44, New York State Route 22, and New York State Route 343, with 500 feet of any other designated roads or the Harlem Valley Rail Trail. The ridgeline visual projection zone includes areas with slopes over 25% and visibility from three or more viewpoints. Whereas Silo has submitted a proposed conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, maintained conservation area and restored conservation area to the town in the form annexed here to a Schedule A, describing 535.97 acres of land identified as a conservation area, indicating the intention of Silo that such conservation area shall constitute the open space required to be preserved by conservation easement as required by the zoning law. Whereas the conservation area is divided into three areas of land: A, the natural conservation area; B, the maintained conservation area; and C, the restored conservation area. Excuse me. With each area having different functions and management goals. Whereas the natural conservation area contains 305.09 acres of undisturbed land containing, among other things, woodlands, wetlands, vernal pools, stream corridors, and is focused on the preservation of important natural ecosystems, their ecological processes, and their biological diversity. The maintained conservation area contains 228.61 acres of land that will be disturbed and subsequently maintained, including a golf course, grasslands, and other maintained areas, and the restored conservation area containing 2.27 acres of land that will be disturbed to facilitate, among other things, the construction of roadways, utility lines, and buildings, and implementation of natural resource restorations. Whereas the maintained conservation area contains a public scenic overlook, which area is subject to a certain public access easement, an agreement between Silo Ridge Ventures Property A, LLC, and the Town of Armenia. Whereas the maintained conservation area and the restored conservation area are focused on buffering the natural conservation area and providing ecological connectivity. Whereas the maintained conservation area and restored conservation area are the subject of conservation easement, maintained and restored areas annexed hereto, and the natural conservation area is a subject to a separate conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants between the same parties to the conservation easement, maintained and restored areas. Whereas the conservation easement, maintain, and restored areas contain a guarantee of payment by Silo Ridge Field Club, LLC as guarantor and owner of the membership club and golf course on the conservation area, which guarantor for itself and successor owners of the club guarantees a full and prompt payment of any and all owner's obligations when due under the conservation easement, maintain, and restored areas, which guarantee is stated to be a continuing guarantee of payment of such obligations, irrespective of the aggregate amount thereof, independent of, in addition and without modification to, and without impairment of any other guarantee or other agreement in connection with the obligations, that the obligations and liabilities of a guarantor shall not be conditioned or contingent on the exhaustion by the holder or the town of any right or remedy either may have against the owner. Now therefore be it resolved that after review and due consideration of all of the foregoing, the town board hereby, one, determines that the conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants maintain conservation area and restore conservation area as proposed will promote and serve to fulfill state and town goals of preserving open land in a scenic, natural, and open condition through conservation restrictions, provide benefits to fish, wildlife, plants, in or similar ecosystems, and provide significant benefits, including scenic enjoyment to the general public. Two, approves the form of the conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, maintain conservation area, and restore conservation area as attached to this resolution, subject to completion of all information to be inserted herein to the satisfaction of the town attorney and the town planning board attorney. And three, hereby authorizes the town supervisor to sign said conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, maintain conservation area and restore conservation area when the same is completed in final form to the satisfaction of the town attorney and the town planning board. I believe we have a
motion was made
a motion
by Mike.
And seconded. We just need the roll.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Councilman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
And Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Resolution 21. Resolution approving form of conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, natural conservation area, by and between Silo Ridge Ventures Property, a LLC owner, and North American Land Trust holder, and the town board of the town of Amenia, and authorizing town supervisor to execute said conservation easement. And I think this is pretty much, where would I start here? Because this is the same as the other two in the beginning.
On the third page,
third paragraph,
on the fourth whereas.
Whereas the natural conservation area is the subject of the conservation easement, natural conservation area annexed hereto, and the maintained conservation area and the restored conservation area will be made subject to a separate conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants that is intended to be executed, held in escrow, then recorded when certain improvements, restoration, and revegetation have been completed in accordance with final approvals and any amendments thereto approved by the planning board. And whereas the conservation easement natural areas contains a guarantee of payment by the owner operator of the membership club and golf course on the conservation area, which owner operator guarantees a full and prompt payment of the owner's obligation under the conservation easement natural areas, which guarantee is stated to be a continuing guarantee of payment of such obligations irrespective of the aggregate amount thereof, independent of, in addition, and without modification to, and without impairment of any other guarantee or other agreement in connection with the obligations, that the obligations and liabilities of the guarantor shall not be conditioned or contingent on the exhaustion of any right or remedy the holder and the town may have against the owner, Now therefore be it resolved that after review, due consideration of all the foregoing, the town board hereby determines that the, one, determines that the conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, natural conservation area as proposed will promote and serve to fulfill state and town goals of preserving open land in a scenic, natural, and open condition, provide benefits to fish, wildlife, plants, and or similar ecosystems, and provide significant benefits, including scenic enjoyment to the general public. Two, approves the form of the conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, natural conservation area as attached to this resolution. Three, authorizes the town.
Can we insert with conditional upon the town attorney's and the planning board attorney's approval of all exhibits to be submitted to the town? So that.
Under number three?
Under number two. So
number two?
Number two, where it begins.
As attached to the resolution?
After a resolution, you would add conditional, comma, resolution, comma, conditional upon the town attorney's and the planning board attorney's approval of all exhibits to be submitted to the town.
Town attorney and the planning board attorney?
Planning board attorneys, those are plural, that's possessive.
To what?
Approval of all exhibits to be submitted to the town.
Three, hereby authorizes the town supervisor to sign such conservation easement and declaration of restrictions and covenants, natural conservation area when the same is completed in final form to the satisfaction of town attorney and town planning board attorney. And we have a motion.
I have a motion, I second that.
Okay, so I make the motion and you're seconding it?
Yes.
Okay.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
Councilman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilman Hitzelberger?
Aye.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Okay, other matters. We were given a request by the building inspector to local people who came forward to obtain a building permit for their property for a handicap ramp. They're requesting that the fee for the building permit be waived as the gentleman has lost his leg and possibly might be losing the second leg and is causing a financial hardship for them.
I make a motion that the building permit fee be waived for the residents who are experiencing financial hardship.
And requesting a handicap ramp.
Second that.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilman
Aye.
Doyle?
Yes.
And Supervisor Perotti?
Yes. And the other matter I have a resolution. What are we up to, 22?
Three.
A transfer of funds for April 2016, whereas the town board has the authority to transfer funds when necessary and unanticipated to amend the budget. Whereas the budget amendment for the general fund, decreasing line 711.4 Amenia Park CE by $1,352.42 for the purchase of youth basketball equipment and referee costs, and increasing line 7310.4 Youth Program CE Youth Basketball by $1,352.42. Now therefore be it resolved, the town board authorizes a transfer of necessary budget lines to process the transaction. Your motion?
I make the motion.
Second.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Aye.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes. The only other thing I have is that the advertisement for planning board secretary and banquet facility Assistant Clerk was done as a legal notice, and I was wondering if we could also advertise in a classified ad with the Poughkeepsie Journal and Millerton News.
Make a motion.
But not only as a legal notice.
Make a motion that the position be advertised
as a classified.
As a classified ad in Poughkeepsie Journal and Millerton News.
Second that.
Discussion. I was wondering if we could add the dance instructor, since Heather Hollihan, who's been doing our program for the last 3 years, may not be available for our fall program, and I think the sooner we know what our options are, the better.
Modify the motion to include a dancing and dance instructor and bank reconciliation and any other open paid position.
Second.
So we'll have them do for our first May meeting?
Yes.
First May meeting. Okay. Councilman Delango?
Yes.
Councilman Gutierrez?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Aye.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Aye.
And Supervisor Perry?
Yes. Public comment? Yes, sir. Town board comments?
I just don't want people to forget the Wasaic Fire Company is having a breakfast and bake sale on Sunday, April 24th, 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. at the firehouse. Enjoy their pancakes, omelets, eggs, bacon, sausage, home fries, toast, coffee, and juice. $8 for adults, seniors 7, $5 for children, and the bake sale. Do enjoy the bake sale. Bring a little extra for that.
Is there any other town board comments?
I would like to express my sincere condolences to the family of Dr. Carney Weeks, who was a physician here for many years and moved away to Maine, but he was a strong member of this community for many, many, many years. I think like 30 years, everybody, a lot of people knew him personally as their doctor and as a friend. His memorial is at 2 p.m. at Lithgow, in Lithgow at St. Peter's Church. And I also regret the passing of George Finn, who was a very important force in the town of Amenia, serving for so many years as the planning board chair and as a an active garden enthusiast whose garden was a big feature on our secret our garden tour that we held every year. So I'm just want to say he'll be missed.
Is there any other town board comments?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
9:13. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
9:13.